Can God be pleased with the life that you're living right now? Can he be pleased with the language that comes out of your mouth right now? Your actions, your ways, your attitude, does it please God? Nobody's perfect. We all are going to fall short, right? All sin and fall short of the glory of God. But thank God for Jesus, right?
Tell them. Tell everybody. Tell everybody the good news of Jesus. Tell everybody the good news of when you receive Christ, what happens. Doesn't mean you don't go through things, but when God takes you through things, he's taking you to something. Our God, when we receive him, is constantly taking you to something. And he's elevating you every single time. And let us not have rebellion in our heart. Let us follow the precepts. Let us follow the commandments. And if you can't remember them, get in the word. Go to God, study the word, and let it be a chain around your heart that no matter where you go, the word goes with you every single place. And eat it like a scroll if you need to, so that out of your mouth, even in your head, which controls your behavior, even if your thought wants to do something, your behavior says, I know you want to go that way, brother, but we gonna go this way because this is where Jesus, our Father, says to go. And then go testify it to everybody, so that people know who Jesus is. It is so easy for us to forget the things that God has done in our life. And what God wants is for us to remember his marvelous works, to stay faithful in him, to stay obedient, to stay in those times with him and not move, so that we can prevail every time those challenges come up, and that we keep him on the throne of our life.
Because the more that we fill ourselves, the less sometimes that we allow God to have. More of us, less of God. And soon we are so full of ourselves, there's no longer any room for God. Beware that you do not forget the Lord your God by not keeping his commandments, his judgments, and his statutes which he has set before you. When God brings us out, he does that so that he can also bring us in. Whenever God has brought you from, God's going to take you to a much better place. And you got to believe that. God's not done with you, but when he brings you out, sometimes there's a barren place where you have to trust God. And that's why he says, obey his commandments, his statutes, and his judgments that he commands us. Now, when you're coming out, when God has brought you out of something, now it's time to seek God with all of your heart. It's not time to find out how to ease up. It's time to give God even more than you have been giving, because God's taking you someplace. But to do that, he's taking you through an endurance situation. There's some things you have to endure as God is dealing with you. Life is a classroom, if you haven't figured that out, right? And if you don't learn the lessons, you just keep repeating the class. And we don't know, some of us are repeating the class because we keep failing the lesson.
Trusting God, not just once, not just when things are good, not just when we got out of the good stuff, got into bad stuff, praise to God and worship to God. He got us out again and now we're with him. But here we are 3 months down the road. We have forgotten what he's done. So when the next challenge come up, we are woe. We are heavy hearted. We are burdened. We are worried. We have fear. God says, if I brought you through that, I'm going to bring you to it again. Don't forget my wonders. Don't forget what I did. And don't become, as he said, a rebellious nation, that because I'm not just giving you the desires of your heart when you want it, I'm not just telling you, hey, you want this, you've got it, or changing my commandment, don't forget me, your God. Because when things are tough, when things are rough, you will seek me, as we all do. How many times when things are rough, we find that more times than not, that's when we're seeking the Lord. We're going in the word. We're going to church. But God says, why not go to church always? Why not pray to me daily? Why not have a relationship with me all the time? Why do we have to leave this spot? Why do you have to go? See, the Lord brought the Bible for a goal to teach us how to prevail, how to have a relationship with him, how to stay the course, how to even when devastation like death of a loved one, which just knocks us to our knees, that just takes our breath away, or even that news from the doctor where you're having to face something that you don't know how you're going to prevail. God says, if you never leave me, you're going to be able to, in that moment, remember what I did for you. You're going to be able to remember where you were here at another moment in your time in your life, and I showed up, that it didn't matter what they said. It didn't matter who said what, because I am your God today, I am your God tomorrow, and I am your God of the future. But if you leave me, if you forget me, if you forsaken me, then how can we have a relationship? God just said in the word in Psalms, but when you need me, I'm there. And even though you turn your back on me over and over and over and over and over again, the thing that I love that God says, I still show you compassion.
There's three things that God says to remember. The first thing he said was to remember his commandments. The second was his judgments. And thirdly, his statutes. Remember those things. His commandments is the word. What does God's word say? We always got to go back to the word of God. Whenever we're struggling, go back to the word. You can never steer wrong when you're going back to the word of God. The word of God is our GPS, it's our guidance, it's our map. And if we stay with that, we will not steer wrong. Because when you're going through the wilderness, we start looking for answers. And we look for all kind of places for answers. We'll talk to 10 people and they'll give us 10 different answers. When God's already given us the answer that we need, it's in his word. So we obey, first of all, God's commandments. Then it says his judgments. God's judgments is walking in his ways. Is everything that you do done so that it pleases God? Can God be pleased with the life that you're living right now? Can he be pleased with the language that comes out of your mouth right now? Your actions, your ways, your attitude, does it please God? Because you're going to be judged on your heart.
The other thing about the word is that he wants us to stay and sustain in a relationship with him so we don't have doubt. We don't have worry. We don't contemplate. We don't shift when we contemplate from God to us. We don't seek now from us. We go to others to seek help outside of God. We don't trust other sources versus just trusting God. We don't start to put things above God versus God being above all things. Because when we start to do that, that starts to lead to the number one thing God says he wants from us is obedience. And we become disobedient. And disobedient is rebellion. Then we become rebellious to God and we start to live a rebellious life. And then on top of that, it leads to us worshiping and looking to other things and putting gods, other gods, as the key, as the answer, as the fixture and the doer to our life, other than our true God. God wants to sustain our relationship with him. You know, when I was looking up this definition, sustain, let me tell you what it means. It says to undergo, to suffer, and experience. So, man, to be sustained means we're going to undergo things. We're going to suffer. We're going to experience things. And the second part of the definition says, but through that sustaining in a relationship with God, we're going to be strengthened. We're going to have support mentally and physically. That means that when we undergo things, that if we sustain our relationship through the word, which is meant to help us sustain it, we're going to sustain all those things we undergo and things that are happening in our life and to our life. And we're going to be able to stay strong mentally and physically. Believe it or not, in the word, it says the testimony belongs to God. He does these things in our life so that we are obedient to testify to others. Think about those that have received Christ already. How did you even know of Christ? How did you even start to believe in him, search him and seek him? It's because of somebody else's testimony about him, somebody else's word about him, somebody else telling you what he did for them and he could do it for you. The testimony of living your life for him and other people seeing it and seeing how God is working in your life. See, the testimony is owned by him. And God says that that is part of what he wants us to do, is to testify to others so that they know he is real, to share the works that he's done in our life and the miracles that he's done, not only yesterday, but even today. That when you see God working in your life, go share it with people. When you have people that receive Christ, go tell them to tell everybody. Don't hide it. Don't be in fear. Go tell everybody, because it could be that God put people around that person, and now that they chose to follow Christ, they're now going to be influenced influence to want to inquire of God, inquire of who Jesus is, and find out they have salvation. And before you know it, they're receiving salvation through Christ. We are to testify, he says. That is the other reason why he wants us to sustain, for him to work in our life, is so we can see him and go share him with other people. So that, he says, that our generation and the generation to come, our children and their children, he said, will know of God, so that we don't have a dying nation. See, one of the issues we have a problem with right now, we're not sharing Jesus enough. We're not telling our neighbor. We're so worried about offending him, so worried about, you know, putting pressure on him. Man, just tell a story about what God did in your life. He then has a choice to receive it, to listen, to do something with it. We need to be praising God and shouting hallelujah and talking about the things that he's done so that people know he is real. And when times come, people won't doubt that our God is sitting on the throne. God has made us his light, us his salt, us and everything that he's done in us. Just because your life is bad, remember what he's done and go and believe and stand. He says, I gave you a rock. And even if somebody strikes your rock, it's still pieces of a rock. And I will put those pieces back together again, but it's still a rock. This is what he's ordering us to do, and to keep his commandments. You guys, I believe wholeheartedly that we are in a moment, and I keep saying it over and over, that we need to count the blessings, count the miracles in our life. We need to take inventory, going all the way back to our childhood, of all the things that God has done. Get a journal, write it down. Remember all the good things, so that when you're having a hard moment, or you feel like, Father, where are you? Or something just hits you over and over, you're losing family members left and right, you can go to the book and you can remember who God is, and you can remember what he did, and you can remember what he's gonna do again. To also take that book and teach it to your children and teach it to your grandbabies, so that they can take God and who Jesus is and salvation to what people are calling a dying nation. We're not a dying nation. We are a living nation. But in order for us to live forever, people must know that there's eternal life. The last time I checked, the Bible is still here. The last time I checked, my God is still here. The last time I checked, and I can pick up a miracle. I can pick up a blessing. I can find it. I can seek it as hard as I seek for him when I'm in trouble. I can seek that hard and find blessings in my life. We woke up this morning, didn't we? We woke up and had breath to see another day. That's a blessing.